हेलो
गुड मॉर्निंग मैडम।
हेलो
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। मॉर्निंग सर,
दिस इज सुब्रमण्यन।
Yes, good morning, sir.
Like this, I can be logged in, no? Message.
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
Sir, till we start, can you mute your audio, sir?
I have to mute my mic.
Yes, sir. Yes, it's mute. Muted now. Ma'am, Kavita ma'am, meedi kuda andaru join ayi manam start chese varaku audio mute cheyara ma'am.
சப்ப பீட்டு கொளுத்துக்கடா, மஜாப்பா மஜாப்பா, இதா 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 இதா
బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి
இது சப்ப பீட்டு கொளுத்துக்கடா மஜாபா மஜாபா
பீட்டு கொளுத்துக்கடா மஜாபா மஜாபா
బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి బిల్లి 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 బిల్లామి
இது சப்ப பீட்டு கொளுத்துகடா ஆ மஜா பா மஜா பா டா 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 ஏ இடுடா வாடா பாத்தி கம்மி ஓகே
Miss Dasari Bhuvaneswari, will you please stop presenting your screen?
Hey, nada idu sappa beete kulthira.
Hello. Dasari Bhuvaneswari.
Majaba, majaba.
Please stop presenting your screen.
Hey, idiga vara. Baati kammi. Okay.
Dasari Bhuvaneswari, can you hear me?
Thank you.
participants, please mute your audio.
Please put up your... Remove them, yeah, because you are the host, we can remove them. Just they're creating.
Yes, sir. Yes, father. She's again. Thank you. Father, shall we start, Father?
Yes.
Dear participants, before we start the session, I request all of you to please mute your audio and video so that it will not cause any disturbance in the during the webinar session. One more thing is feedback forms will be given during the end of the webinar. So, Reverend Father Victor Emmanuel, Principal of Andhra Loyola College, Sri Professor Dr. Perumal Subramanian, today's speaker and resource person, my dear colleagues, students, and all participants, a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the national webinar on role of biological clock in health and disease. Firstly, I invite our beloved principal, Reverend Father Victor Emmanuel S.J., to address the gathering and greet us.
Good morning, everyone. Dr. Subramanian Perumal and Dr. Sri Lakshmi and others, welcome to this webinar being conducted by our own department. And the topic, biological clock. Biological clock, every living thing has got a biological makeup in ourselves. As all of you know, we learn from things, we learn from birds, we learn from animals. We fly to learn because birds fly. We learn to resist things from the insects. We learn how to digest various things by observing various animals, how they digest. Even immunity comes from the animals. We learn from them. Why we have to learn from them? Because we are also animals. We have forgotten that we are also animals. Because of our reason, we don't follow our biological clock. Everybody has got our own biological makeup, biological thing that controls us. We overrule it sometimes, or we obey it, or we underplay it, and that's why there is some disturbance in our health system. Biological clock is inbuilt because God has created everything perfectly. That's what even Bible says. Everything says at the end of the creation, God says everything is good, and He was happy. That's what Christianity believes, and every religion believes, I suppose, that we are all the most perfect being that God could create. But still we face a lot of calamities, a lot of diseases because of our own making. Many say it is our own making. Even coronavirus is created, they say. It's created, it is allowed because of Wuhan, the animals, the live animals being eaten, which is against the nature, and it is spread from animals to human beings. So we all know that we have not followed certain cycles that is very natural to us. So I'm very happy that we have this particular webinar on this COVID-19, where if we have followed natural biological clock. Biological clock, as you know, it is not a new term. Some it may be new, but definitely a new insights we are expecting from our resource person, honorable resource person, Subramanian Perumal, Dr. Subramanian Perumal, Annamalai University. So nice to come to Loyola College to expose and enlighten our minds on this particular topic, so that as much as possible we stay healthy. There is nothing so happy, nothing so beautiful than having a good health. So if you have a good health, crores and crores of rupees having is nothing, because you are not able to eat properly, or you're not able to see properly, and you're not able to walk properly. So many small, simple things. These simple things, when they miss only, come to know the beauty of health. beauty of health. So if you are having health, you are having everything. You have everything. In many movies I have seen, they so many precious things are very freely given, but we don't respect them. Air is free, water free, our life is free. We have not bought our life, but these things are free, but we don't maintain it. We pollute our mind, pollute nature, pollute our clock, we disorient our clock, we change our things according to our own whims and fancies, and then naturally the clock is disturbed and it has to get adjusted. So much so, we have disturbed even the nature. Once I was attending a seminar in Calcutta, they were saying even birds forget when to sing, even flowers forget when to flower, because the seasonal, we have interfered with the nature so much, they forgot their own clock, which is winter, which is summer, which is spring, they forgot. Because we interfere so much, some of the fruits don't get on time, some of the things don't happen on time. This is the whole world is going through a kind of crisis because we have not respected the nature. So this seminar will remind us how much we need to respect the body, respect the natural thing that is ingrained in us, in the nature, in our body, so that we become attuned. That's what all Hindu philosophy is. We must be, all nature is one. All nature is one. We are not separate from the nature. We have to take care of the nature. Nature will take care of us. Otherwise, we have to pay the price. So this is all we are all ingrained in one another, imbibed in one another. So there is a saint, Saint Francis, in Christianity. He calls the whole creation as brother and sister. He calls the sun a brother and the moon a sister. So in the sense, we are one with this. We are not separate from this. We exploit the nature, but we are paying the price. The calamities in the Bombay, unprecedented, within 4 hours, unprecedented rain. In Kerala, landslides, unprecedented. These are all man-made. We cut trees unnecessarily, we store up. You go to any forest, an animal will not kill more than what it needs. If there may be 100 herds, it will kill only one because that is what it needed for eating. But we store up things, we kill things, we destroy things, hectares of calamity things take place just to make a paper money which is useful for nothing. We don't know the same after 1,000 years, the rupees that we have any value. Afterwards, the whole thing may change. Barter system may come in. We don't know. So we are interfering too much with the nature. So I welcome the name of Loyola College. Our Loyola College, as you know, Perumal Garu, ninga Loyola College pakkathula irukinga adukku pirada than idu vanduchi. So after that college, those fathers came and started this. We are the first autonomous college in both the Telugu state, 36th rank in NIRF ranking. And Annamalai University, twice or thrice I visited because I studied my philosophy in Thiruvannamalai, and the Thiruvannamiyur, which is near Adyar, you must be knowing. So I welcome you. I also, Annamalai University is also our great President Abdul Kalam used to a visiting professor. He has got such a great institute. You are coming and enlightening our minds. Once again, I welcome every one of you to be part of this. Well, accepting our invitation, taking your time to be with us. I appreciate the organizers, especially Madam and the department members. Once again, I welcome the name of the Loyola College. Have a very good time. If you have any doubts, you can clarify and enrich yourselves. Thank you very much. Once again, in the name of Loyola College, I welcome you. In the name of the department also, I welcome you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. Thank you for the inspiring and knowledgeable words. Now, I, Sri Lakshmi Samanchi, Head of the Department of Biotechnology, Andhra Loyola College, take the opportunity to introduce our today's resource person, Sri Perumal Subramaniam Garu.
Dr. P. Subramanyam Garu is a professor at Department of Biochemistry and Biotechnology at Annamalai University, Tamil Nadu. He is also a visiting professor at Chronotherapeutic de Cancerous, University of Paris, France, School of Life Sciences, Pandit Ravishankar Shukla University, Raipur, and also in the Department of Molecular Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Sir's main area of research is in molecular chronobiology. He has completed 7 national research projects sanctioned by UGC, DRDE, DST, ICMR, with a total worth of about rupees 80 lakhs, and also 1 international research project at University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. He has delivered about 30 special lectures in India, Thailand, France, and Malaysia. His publications include H Index and Citations from Scopus, with about 121 Sky Indexed publications. There are about 7 book chapters published by him. Currently, he is guiding 21 PhD students and 34 MPhil students with 1 postdoctoral. Sir has bagged many awards, of which UGC Mid-Career Award in 2018 and Recognition Award for Reviewing with Distinction by Singapore Medical Journal in 2016. Dear participants, despite all these achievements, Sir is actually very humble and down to earth. Right from the first phone call regarding this webinar, he has always been very friendly and approachable. So I feel very happy to associate with him today for this webinar session. Dear Professor Perumal Subramanyam Garu, welcome to our webinar. And now the webinar is open for you, sir.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Madam Sri Lakshmi. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to everyone. Respected Principal of the College, Reverend Father G.M. Victor Emmanuel, sir. Madam Sri Lakshmi Samanchi, Head Department of Biotechnology, Andhra Loyola College, Vijayawada. Happy to meet you and all. At the outset, I would like to thank our respected Principal Victor Emmanuel Garu and Madam Sri Lakshmi for giving me this opportunity to present the talk on biological clock, its role in health and disease. As our principal rightly told, all of us are having this biological clock. Even bacteria are having this clock. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to introduce this topic. You are more welcome to ask any doubts or questions at the end of the talk. So simply, we are living in Earth. We are not living in Mars or any other planet. This Earth is having a light-dark cycle from the sun, 12 hours of light and 12 hours of darkness. So although some millions of years back, this light dark cycle is shorter than 24 hours. When dinosaurs had lived in this world, the light dark cycle period was only 22 hours. But evolutionarily, the rotation of the Earth has been changed, and now it is 12:12 in tropical countries like India. And we are living in a 24-hour light dark cycle environment. So evolutionarily, our body has also built to be evolved to cope up with this light dark cycle. So our body, in this sense, almost all the biological processes in our body, starting from our sleep-wake cycle, our biochemistry, body physiology, endocrinological functions, and why not cell division, and up to gene regulation, it is oriented with the 24-hour light-dark cycle. If there is any problem in that, it leads to problems in our health. The study of the biological clock is basically this chronobiology. It is not only study the peripheral physiological processes, but also its underlying mechanisms in humans, in mammalian systems, and as our respected principal told, in birds, in insects, and also in bacteria. Cyanobacteria, blue-green algae are having are known to have very good biological clock functions. So in my presentation, I am using various sources from which I have collected information. So it is ethical to show all the references and presentation sources in the even in the beginning of the talk. So in the next three slides, I have collected references and materials from these sources which I will be using. I will be using some of the pictures, some of the information, some of the notes from all these references. So I am showing these because it is unethical if we don't quote all these references. So biological clock is ubiquitous in nature. Almost all our bodily functions is tuned, is orchestrated to the 24-hour LIDAR cycle, whether it is 12:12 as it is happening in India, or as it is happening in Western countries, it may be 16:8. But it is a 24-hour periodicity. So there is an innate endogenous biological clock in our body that is called SCN. In this picture, you might have seen it, SCN. That is a suprachiasmatic nuclei, a group of 10,000 neurons located bilaterally in the anterior hypothalamic tract. That is called a biological clock. That is the master biological clock present actually in the brain in the anterior hypothalamus portion. This biological clock receives the information from environmental cycle. You can see this sunrise and moon, sun and moon in the picture. So that is that information is received to the biological clock by this RHT, retinohypothalamic tract, which is a separate neuronal projection other than the optic tract. And there are other regions in the brain. In brain, you know, there are interconnections, there are afferent and different projections that are protruding from one area to another. So paraventricular nucleus, pineal body, all these are involved in generating the rhythm. And you can see the rhythmic functions in almost all the systems of our body, autonomic nervous system, endocrine system, immune system, digestive system. Almost all these, all the, as I told, it is ubiquitous. Almost all the functions are rhythmic in nature. It is having about 24-hour periodicity. There are not one in the brain. There is SCN, that is the master clock, which is controlling all these rhythms. So, but we have various organs and various tissues like stomach, liver, intestine, and kidney. So in these peripheral organs, there are separate peripheral clocks that have been located. And all these peripheral clocks are coordinated and controlled by the brain. So this SCN, suprachiasmatic nucleus, is like the central government. And all these peripheral clocks in the peripheral organs are like state governments. So there is a, in the body, there is a perfect coordination between this SCN and all other peripheral organs. And there is input in the form of LIDAR cycle to the SCN, to the central biological clock, and there are outputs in the slide you might have seen. All these are output rhythmic processes, starting homeostasis, body temperature regulation, blood pressure. Similarly, in the peripheral clocks, I mean in the each and every organ, there are inputs for the functioning of the biological clock, and there are also outputs, as you see. The lipogenesis and metabolism of drugs, metabolism of carbohydrate, protein, they are essentially being done in the liver. Brain is not doing the metabolism. So there are 24-hour rhythmicities in the liver. For that for that functions, there are separate inputs, liver gas, or by means of a nervous system, and the output processes it is executing. Similarly, even in the urine excretion rate, glomerular output, there are 24-hour rhythms, and there is a perfect coordination between these peripheral clocks located in various organs and also with the central biological clock. So this is another picture showing this how this biological clock is located and how these neuronal projections are emitting protruding from the brain area. You can see optic nerve. So this optic chiasm, our vision is also received by the brain, you know. So that is a separate neuronal projection called optic nerve, which is also ending in the hypothalamus region. In the same hypothalamus region, our SCN is located, suprachiasmatic nuclei is located, but the neuronal projection is different. Via the optic nerve, suprachiasmatic nucleus doesn't receive any input, any neuronal input, but it has the separate neuronal projection like retino-hypothalamic tract. And there are, to the adjacent areas of hypothalamus, there are numerous projections that are protruding out. And from them, the efferent projections are going on to all over the mammalian body. And particularly this hormone, melatonin, which is secreted from the pineal gland, is very, very important. It is called the internal shade giver, internal time-giving signal to our body, because when melatonin rises, we are going to sleep. Whenever we go to sleep, even during daytime nap, the melatonin hormone is elevated. So it is the main internal shade giver, which is playing key role in regulating our sleep-wake cycles. And all our physiological, endocrinological, and biochemical functions and cellular processes, which are going on inside the cell, are associated with this sleep-wakefulness cycle. So, light-dark cycle input is the main source by which we are receiving the temporal information about our environment, about the environmental conditions. But similarly, all other functions that we are doing can also act as a shade giver or as a time giving signal to our body. For instance, the food and feeding regimens, that is also giving information about the time to our central biological clock, SCN. Not only that, there are feedback. We are doing exercise and we are sleeping. Our heart functions are different. All these are exhibited. All these temporal processes are exhibited by the central biological clock, and in turn, these functions have a feedback time information input to our central biological clock. And these biological rhythms, these 24-hour processes in all our functions, are not exogenously controlled. They are endogenously present. They are endogenous in nature. They are innate. That 24-hour, that periodicity is not exactly 24-hour, but our innate biological clock is around 24-hour. It is not exactly fit into 24-hour period. Our sleep-wake cycle as such endogenously is about 24-hour. It may be 23.5-hour or 23-hour for a person, or it may be 24.5 or 25 for a different kind of a person. So they are endogenous in nature. Not only endogenous, they are genetic in nature. There are certain genes which we are going to see in these slides. There are a number of 6 to 10 genes which are called clock genes. Genes are involved in the generation and the regulation of all our rhythmic functions. The rhythms are ubiquitous, but all these functions are regulated by these genes called circadian clock genes. Although people have known that these rhythms are genetic in nature, and there are various genes controlling these rhythmic processes, these three gentlemen, Jeff Hall, Michael Rochebosch, and Michael W. Young, they have discovered the molecular mechanisms of these genes and how they are involved in the circadian rhythm. And you might be knowing that in 2017, the prestigious Nobel Prize has been awarded to three of them. All the three have shared the prize. Now people are giving importance to the subject after this Nobel Prize. So since all our rhythmic, all our process, biological process or rhythmic in nature, it has three examples. For instance, plasma melatonin. You see that the red color bar, orange bar, is a dark period, and white is a light period. You see the melatonin levels are high only during night when we go to sleep. The opposite is our body temperature. Our body when we are in deep sleep, REM sleep, our body temperature is low because all our metabolic processes, even heart rate, heart pulse, peripheral blood flow, kidney functions are all minimum. Our body temperature is slowed down, and these rhythms are recurrent in nature. If you are living in a perfect 24-hour LiDAR cycle. These rhythms are recurrent and they are repeatedly occurring in our body. And you see plasma cortisol. As soon as we wake up in the morning, at the end of a dark period, the plasma cortisol is having its maximum level. There is a perfect coordination. Cortisol is secreted by the adrenal gland. Melatonin is secreted by the pineal gland. And similarly, all other functions are independently performed by various organs in our body. But there is a perfect coordination because of the central biological clock, which is located in the HCN, in the anterior hypothalamus. So that is what depicted in this picture. Without this coordination, there is a miscoordination and the body function cannot be proper, and that itself will lead to problems in our health. As a matter of fact, in some persons, there is lack of coordination between this central biological clock and these peripheral clocks, which lead to various kinds of diseases, which we will be seeing in the future slides. So this SCN is very, very important. If there is no SCN, if in the case of a brain tumor in the anterior hypothalamus region, if SCN is affected, if these cells are lesioned, and if these SCN cells are degenerated, what is happening? Our rhythmic functions are completely affected. We cannot have a perfect sleep and wakefulness. That itself will shorten our lifespan. That is this example that is given here. You see that the blue color patch, that is a immunohistochemical stain of this SCN in the anterior hypothalamus. Without staining, it is shown in the left side picture. When the SCN is intact, normal and good, you can see the body temperature. Our body temperature rhythm is perfect. You can see peak and trough periodically in every 24 hours. Totally 144 hours are giving. Every 24 hours, you get a very good peak and a nadir. So this is good. But you see the top picture where in which the SCN cells are lesioned, they are removed, and there is no rhythm city. So this is only one example. Not only the body temperature, all our bodily functions, if they are rhythmic, and if all the hormones are very high at all the times, or if are very, very low at all the times, then there is no proper functioning in the physiology and in all cellular processes. So that is the problem. That is how this biological clock is important. It has been already established in various kinds of patients. There is no exception. We will say two examples only. Alzheimer's disease patient and Hashimoto's disease patient. Both are neurodegenerative disorders. In control subjects, in normal subjects, you see that a black bar and a white line. That means that the black bar indicates that activity period, our activity period, and the white line without that the black bar is represents the sleep period. So normal subject is perfectly rhythmic. He is going to sleep regularly, periodically, and regularly he is active. But the same condition you see in that the AD patient, Alzheimer's disease patient, no perfect sleep, no rhythmicity in the sleep. He is sleepless, or during daytime he is getting sleeping. And he is active throughout the day and night, which is not good. The clock function is affected. And all not only is not suffering from brain function, but all other cellular processes and physiological processes, BP, glucose level, everything is affected. Same thing is happening in the Hashimoto disease patient. As he told, the perfect perfect activity period like this and rest period, which is absent in the Hashimoto disease patient. So as we get older, you see in the brain itself, there are a lot of changes happening. Majority of the brain cells are not functioning as good as we are very, very young. So that mainly lead to problems in our biological clock. Particularly, our melatonin secretion is affected. In a young and a normal SCN, there is a very good secretion of melatonin during dark time. So he is going to sleep. Associated with this very good sleep-wakefulness cycle, all his body functions are very good, and they are temporarily organized in a very good way. But you see, when the SCN is partially lesioned, not completely lesioned, the SCN is located bilaterally. So at one side, if you lesion it, somehow the rhythmic function is maintained. the amplitude of the melatonin rhythm is lowered and the periodicity is somehow shortened, but still there is somehow some rhythmic function is happening. But if it is completely lesioned, then it is a complete lack of our sleep wake cycle and all our bodily functions. As we get older, the aged SCN is equivalent to that of partially lesioned. So you might have heard in your families and other older people might be saying, I am not getting sleep. My sleep is very poor. 1 hour or 2 hours sleep only. I'm getting only in the early morning. Many old people have complaining about have been complaining about this. So this is because mainly the SCN, particularly, it is not functioning properly, not coordinating with the peripheral clocks and all these problems or RIC. So these are in this picture. You are seeing important anatomical areas in the brain. Areas in blue color, they are involved in energy homeostasis. These white color patches, dorsomedial hypothalamus and SCN, supracrassemedial nucleus, ventral supraventricular zone. These three are main areas connected, associated with this rhythmic function. And you see, there are hormonal signals and neuronal projections in the brain. Hormonal projections are seen in the SCN, in VMH and the dorsomedial hypothalamus, mainly leptin, insulin and relin associated with the energy metabolism and the energy regulation in our body is having inputs to all these areas, and all these are interconnected. Arcuate nucleus and the paraventricular nucleus, energy homeostasis is connected very well. And because of all these projections, our all the rhythmic functions are perfectly coordinated in our body. If any problems in any of these neuronal projections or any problem in the hormonal signal, that for number one that is happening in our body is the 24-hour oscillation, 24-hour variation in the important energy homeostasis function of our body is affected. So, because there are ubiquitous biological processes which are rhythmic in nature, the most of the drugs that we take or the symptoms of the disease, they are rhythmic in, they have a time-dependent variation in our body. The chronopharmacology is study of rhythmic, predictable, in-time differences in the effects. And our pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics, I hope you know, the absorption of the drug, distribution of the drug, metabolism of the drug, and the excretion of the drug. So, all these four processes are dealt in the pharmacology. But there is a chronopharmacokinetics also, because there is a time dependent variation in the absorption of any drug that we are taking, and there is a time dependent variation in the distribution of the drug. And the enzyme levels show these 24-hour rhythms. Of course, there is a variation in the metabolism. Even in the receptor levels are changing periodically. And all because of, and there is a kidney function is also rhythmic in nature. And because of this, there is a perfect time-dependent variation in the pharmacokinetics of the drug. That is, chronopharmacokinetics is a branch of chronopharmacology, because this is very, very important, because you need to administer the drug only at the correct time to the patient. If it is administered randomly at random time points, then there is no meaning. It is leading to unwanted side effects, and the desired effects are lacking. So that is the problem. So this was known as early as 1814 by a scientist called J.J. Wiry. He first discovered that the desirable and the undesirable effect of a drug is based on the time of the administration of the drug. Even the toxicity varies. The toxicity of any particular toxin is not uniform throughout the 24-hour period. The example given here is nicotinamide, CNS stimulant, and it showed a variation at two hours, 2 o'clock. That means 2 a.m. It is a different 33% less toxicity compared to daytime 2 p.m. There is 65-67% it is highly toxic than this nighttime period. There is a separate branch called chronotherapeutics. When a particular drug is to be administered, so this is the branch of chronobiology. So you say the liver absorption, distribution in our circulatory system, metabolism. I'm sorry, the first one A is stomach. From stomach, most of these drugs which we are taking orally are absorbed and they are distributed by in the circulatory system. These drugs are metabolized in the liver, and there may be most of these drugs are excreted via the kidney, as you know, ADME, absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. That is pharmacokinetics. But you see, there is a clock picture in each and every organ. That is, there is a time dependent variation which is innate and endogenous. Again, they are all, I need not say, they are genetically controlled. As because of this, not only there is a pharmacokinetics, but there is a chronopharmacokinetics also. So it is our efficacy of the drug is good only if at a proper time, if we take the drug, that is very good. Otherwise, only side effects will be there. The desired effects of the drug will be very, very minimal. So this drug optimization is solved by this branch of study called chronopharmacology. So the picture here shows you that blood pressure variation. Hello, am I audible, madam? Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
So the person is wearing this ambulatory blood pressure monitor. That is all the 24-hour period, even when you are asleep, when you are active, when you are listening to music, or when you are watching a movie. Through blood pressure can be monitored using this device, ambulatory blood pressure monitor. This is the variation in systolic and diastolic blood pressure. You see this white bar that indicates daytime. The dark bar is nighttime. You see the dark time, the blood pressure is lowered, and during daytime you get the two peaks, a primary peak and a secondary peak. So this variation is recurrent in nature. This is the endogenous rhythm, blood pressure rhythm. So that rhythmicity is affected. That rhythmicity is different in hypertensive patients. You see systolic and diastolic blood pressure, they are high, they are elevated, but still there is a rhythmicity. There is a rhythmicity in the blood pressure. So it is obvious that there is no point in giving the drug, antihypertensive drug, at this time point when already the blood pressure is lowered. Here there is no point. When we have the peak in the blood pressure, at that time if the antihypertensive drugs are administered, then the side effects will be minimal and the efficacy of the drug is also increased. So for that we need to study the blood pressure rhythm for these hypertensive patients. So such a kind of treatment, such a kind of investigation is going on in Western countries, although not popular in India. So this is about death in the cardiovascular events. You see morning 6 to 12, the stroke, acute myocardial infarction, and the sudden cardiac death are maximum. I'm not saying at all other time points these cardiovascular events are not happening. They are happening, but the maximum, the riskier time, we say good time and bad time. But there is a scientific basis for this. Nowadays, we are coming to know about this. Although it is happening, cardiovascular events are happening all the time points. During this time period is the most riskier one. It is reported in several countries, not in from a single country. Same myocardial infarctions you see, although it is happening at all time points, in the morning hours, as soon as after sunrise, there is a peak in the myocardial infarction and other cardiovascular events and even cardiac death. All of us know about this day-night pattern of this asthma. Asthma patients, they have the breathing difficulty. Dyspnea is very high during nighttime. During daytime, they are almost like normal, healthy subjects. But you say that early morning hours, that period, they feel like hell because the difficulty in breathing is very, very high compared to less than death. And less than 10, you see more than 350. So there is no point in giving a drug at this time point. Only we need to give the drug based on the pharmacokinetics of that particular drug. If this time point, if this is administered, not only the symptoms are relieved, but other unwanted effects will also be minimum. So there is a scientific basis for these cardiovascular events and also for this day-night pattern of asthma. You see cortisol, which is controlling this vasodilation along with the epinephrine. These two are low. The smooth muscle contraction is lowered. Not only that, there is vasoconstriction that is also happening. You know that beta adrenergic receptors are involved in a smooth muscle relaxation and vascular dilatation. If the beta 2 adrenergic receptors are low, then the smooth muscle relaxation as well as vasodilation is not proper. It lead to vasoconstriction and the difficulty in the smooth muscle relaxation. Airway inflammatory cells are more during nighttime. The vagal activity is elevated. Body temperature is lower because of the combination of all these six. There is a airway limitation and there is a hyperactivity of the airway in the lungs related to this dyspnea, particularly during nighttime. So the chronotokinetic drugs of numerous drugs, hundreds of drugs have been performed and publications have been made. Here I have listed some drugs like halothane, prostaglandin, reserpine, cyproheptadine, insulin, chlorothiazide, and so on and so forth. So all functions here in this diagram, only few functions are represented, but hundreds of our bodily functions are rhythmic in nature. Let us start from 6 a.m. where you get the elevation in the cortisol level. Not only that, the catecholamine levels are increased. Along with that, blood pressure, heart rate are elevated, vascular resistance is more, platelet adhesiveness is more, blood viscosity is more. So you see, all these are high from during this period, mostly, most predominantly, the blood pressure, arterial compliance, vascular resistance, cell plate adhesiveness, including cell viscosity, they are all high at this time point, as soon as after 6 a.m. So that is the main reason for the higher incidence of cardiovascular events, mostly in the morning hour. At this time, afternoon, the hemoglobin levels are very high, respiratory rate is high, insulin is high, body insulin levels are very high at this time point, cholesterol synthesis and triglyceride synthesis. Most of the enzymes involved in the cholesterol synthesis and the triglyceride synthesis are high. The evening, 6 o'clock, the diuresis, peripheral blood flow, later in the evening. Similarly, other hormones, our WBC, are high. During nighttime, after 6 p.m., after midnight, you see all these hormones and the cell lymphocytes level. Melatonin, you see, this peak is at this time point. So we get a deep sleep, REM sleep, mostly around 3 a.m. We get the REM sleep because of the highest level of melatonin in the body. Follicle stimulating hormone, ACTH, are also rhythmic and they are recurrent in nature. So because all these coordinated and numerous functions are rhythmic, let us say, suppose if SCN is lesioned, there is not a proper body clock. What is happening is all these important rhythmic functions are affected, so it leads to cumulative damage to our body. So in cancer, enormous research has been done. There is a dosing time variation, dosing time dependency in the tolerability of the anti-cancer drug, and there are numerous rhythms involved in the determination of this toxicity. So this experiment has been done in murine model systems, the time-dependent variation of the anti-cancer drugs. This is a rat. The rat is opposite sleep-wake cycles to humans, as you know. During nighttime, dark phase, the animal is active. During daytime, the animal takes rest, isn't it? So all these are anti-cancer drugs. Anti-cancer drugs, the maximum efficacy of the drug at this particular time point is high. 5-fluorouracil maximum effect has been seen only at this time point. So it is good if we administer the drug only at this time point. In this list, you may also see these X-rays. X-rays, which is frequently used for the radiotherapy of cancer. You see, even X-rays, they are not uniformly effective at all time points. At this time point, the effect, actually this is the time point where the X-rays are highly efficient. Why? Because the cancer cell division, tumor growth rate, cell division in the tumor itself is rhythmic. Mostly at this time point, the cancer cells are divided more. So it is good at this time point, if X-rays are, if they are exposed to radiotherapy, there is improvement in the therapy. And at this time point, the drugs are also tolerable at a larger extent. So this is about 5-fluorouracil tolerability in mice, and the same thing. They have taken three different strains of the drug, and they have monitored the survival rate, because these anti-cancer drugs are they kill normal cells also, because when they stop the DNA synthesis and the cell division in cancer cells, normal cells are also affected. Because of that, the tolerability is less. But at this time point, at mid-rest and mid-activity, you see the variation. At the mid-rest, the 5-fluorouracil is most tolerable, most efficient than this mid-activity time point in three different strains of mice, when they are tested with three different strains of mice. So without considering the circadian function, the 24-hour variation, if we administer drug, our drug is 50% less efficient. On the other hand, if we consider the circadian timing, our biological rhythm into account, and we administer the drug as per this rhythmic phenomenon, there is an increase, 50% increase in the efficacy of the drug. Why it is like that? Because all, as we see, the metabolism is rhythmic, proliferation of the cells, they are rhythmic, even apoptosis. The programmed cell death is rhythmic in nature. 24-hour oscillation has been established. DNA repair that is happening, that is also rhythmic. So basically, all these four, they contribute to the rhythmic variation in the efficacy of the drug. And the highest efficacy time is the best tolerance time. So the difficulty in cancer therapy is we need to depend on not only the single drug, but a combination of cytotoxic drug. But the time-dependent variation of a particular drug is different from the time-dependent variation of another drug. Okay, for example, at 6 p.m., a particular drug may be efficient. Another drug at 12 noon. So there is a temporal variation. So because of this, there is a problem for the combined chemotherapy, for the administration of two or more anti-cancer drugs. This problem has been solved in the Western countries by having the chronotherapeutic multi-channel pumps. So this is like ambulatory blood pressure monitor, which is monitoring the blood pressure over day and night for three to four days, depending upon the battery condition. Continuously it will be monitored. So like this, in Western countries, particularly in France, this slide is from France only, the chronotherapeutic breast cancers hospital, Valprus in Paris. This chronomodulated combination chemotherapy has been performed by which you have a device called a multi-channel pump, and there are you can admit four different drugs, and based on the chrono tolerability or chrono efficacy of the drug, the maximum level of the drug can be administered to the body. It can be there is a centralized programmation that we can do. Modulation in the delivery rate based on the time can be done. There are four reservoirs having 100 to 2000 ml, two independent channels are there. So this is a variation. 1 ml to 3000 ml variation of the administration of the drug can be done, and this can be attached to the body like this. As this person is having, this can be attached, and the drug will be administered to the body according to the maximum efficacy of the drug. Here in this example, you see there are three different anti-cancer drugs are administered: oxaliplatin, 5-fluorouracil, and leucovorin, mainly for the colorectal cancer patients. So at this time point, if you administer oxaliplatin, the efficacy is more. So accordingly, at this time, that the chronomodulated drug delivery system will administer the drug, and the 5-fluorouracil and the leucovorin, if they are administered at this time point, it is good. So the device itself administering the at this time point, along with that, there are four channels, isn't it, in the delivery system. So via the another channel, the glucose, 5% glucose is delivered to the cancer patient. So that his body metabolism and his body activities can be normal. So that also you see there is a variation in the glucose delivery rate to this body. So this chronomodulated drug delivery system is very, very important to increase the efficacy of our drug, not only for cancer and for all other diseases. Now with the knowledge of genomics and nanomedicine, this knowledge can be applied to chronobiology and chronopharmacology, and we can simulate models, and we can predict the effect of various chrono drug delivery system, leading to the improvement of the efficacy of the drug. So at present, that research is going on. Although this chronomodulated drug delivery systems is not available on the market in India, but in US and in France and in other Western countries, this is well known. These chronotherapeutic drug delivery systems for Verampil and for hypertension, this is already in practice from 1996, from 2003, and even in USA, there are chrono drug delivery systems available in the market of USA and also in Japan for asthma, for ulcer, for hyperlipidemia, for hypertension, and so on and so forth. I have listed a few examples in this slide. So that the chronotherapy, the patients receiving chronotherapy is increasing day by day. So the symptoms, peak time of symptoms of numerous diseases is depicted here. Bronchitis, rheumatoid arthritis, allergic. Yes, we have seen the sudden cardiac death, thrombotic and hemorrhagic stroke, sickle cell anemia, and peptic ulcer, epitaxis, osteoarthritis. These symptoms are high at this time. Epilepsy is high. So based on this, the chronotherapy can be scheduled. Here I am giving a few other examples. Here you see cholesterol synthesis is elevated. In the previous slide, one of the slides also we have seen at this time point, cholesterol synthesis is high. Depression. Depression is the symptoms are worst in the morning. Asthma and other examples, you can see the cold and flu symptoms are more in the morning as soon as you wake up. for hello, breast cancer, for renal cell cancer. So the dosing schedule, in the previous slide we have seen oxaliplatin, leucovorin and 5-fluorouracil. For other kind of cancers also, these chronomodulator drug delivery systems are available. Here the time point and the tumor type has been represented. Not only for cancer, congenital hypoplasia, chronic kidney disease, atherothrombosis, osteoporosis, for all these diseases, chronomodulator drug delivery system is very useful, and already they have been clinically trialed and found to be successful in Western countries. There are number of drugs which show daily variations in the in their effect. It has been established from the clinical studies, cardiovascular active agents, all these drugs are known to have variation, anti-asthmatic drugs, even psychotropic drugs, and even drugs used in ophthalmological problems. Their efficacy is having a time-dependent variation. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, local anesthetics, opioids, all these are examples for that, which are known to show daily variations, and several drugs used for our hormonal problems and used in ulcer are well-known. So morning dosing schedule of methylprednisolone, it has been introduced in 1960s, and it is the first chronotherapy that has been applied into the clinical practice. And we have seen that asthma symptoms are high in the early morning, but based on the chronopharmacokinetics of the drug, we need not administer the drug at 10 a.m. or in the midnight. But if you say only once, daily dosing, the drug is distributed high when the symptoms are high. That means in the early morning, the distribution of the drug is high and it reaches the lungs, and these asthmatic symptoms are minimized. Similarly, verapamil, it is used to minimize the hypertension based on this chronotherapy. And we have seen in the slide this HMG-CoA reductase, the rate-limiting enzyme of the cholesterol synthesis, is high only during nighttime. So if to minimize the hyperlipidemia, hypercholesterolemia, we have to administer the drug only at the evening. So at that time, when the rate-limiting enzyme is high, the enzyme activity is blocked by our drug, so that hyperlipidemia can be minimized. At other time points, for example, in the morning, if the patient takes the anti-hyperlipidemic drug, there is no point, because by the time all the drug that is taken has been metabolized completely by the liver, and by the evening it is almost no drug is available. So that is that the drug is not useful. Not only that, the side effects, the drug is having all other effects in our body. So the disease condition is not relieved, but the subject, the patient is receiving some other problems. Similarly for ulcer, here the dosing time has been given, and the bedtime administration of hypnotics for sleep problems, for androgen, and so on and so forth. The only few examples I have given here, you can go through Google and you can see how this chronotherapy is important. So there is a chronopharmacological recommendations that have been made by this German Medical Association, morning dose, and studying the blood pressure in the hypertensive patient is essential, and the chronotherapy of corticosteroids in Addison's disease, the hypofunction of the adrenal gland. We should not administer corticosteroids at all time points, but only chronotherapy is recommended. Not only that, the diagnosis only at particular time if you do, then it is more useful. For example, allergy, testing the hypersensitive reaction of allergens. It varies based on the time of the day. At the wrong time, if we do the test and we can say the person is not allergic to that particular allergen, is wrong. For example, cutaneous reaction to intradermal antigen test, they are 2 to 3-fold greater in the evening than in the morning. So the better time for testing the allergens is in the evening. Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, the airway patency test is best in the afternoon and poor. The office goers may have time only in the evening, and if 8 o'clock, if he goes to the hospital and if he test this airway patency test, it is not useful. The patient has only, not only that, early morning, best time to assess the severity of asthma, and other time it is showing variations, giving wrong results. Glaucoma, the intraocular pressure highest during sleep and lowest in the afternoon. So in the afternoon, the test should not be conducted. Even diabetes glucose tolerance test different in the morning than in the afternoon. Not only that, based on your hormonal rhythms in the body, based the different times of the menstrual cycle, and why not different seasons of the year, is also having a control on the glucose tolerance test, leading to wrong results. So there are genes, circadian clock genes, mainly controlling rhythm processes. So mainly all these rhythmic functions are grossly associated. So suppose if there is a mutation, if there is a genetic disorder in the clock gene, what is happening to the normal sleep duration of the subject? Naturally, it is getting affected, leading to innate sleep disorders. The patient is not getting sleep because of the environmental conditions, or due to light exposure, or due to tension or worrying. But that the problem is genetic in nature. Nowadays, there are a lot of studies that have yielded results. So there must be importance how to rectify that genetic inheritance to control these sleep problems is very important. And you might have heard about this seasonal affective disorder. The 24-hour LIDAR cycle is important. In India, we are fortunate because we are almost getting 12 hours of light and 12 hours of sunlight and 12 hours of darkness. What about the Scandinavian countries? During fall and during winter, the people in the Scandinavian countries are getting only very low amount of sunlight. Sunlight they are getting is very, very low, which is not enough to coordinate the rhythmic functions in them, leading to seasonal affective disorder to the people living in the Scandinavian countries. They are getting, during winter season, they are having this sad seasonal affective disorder, that sleep is very minimum. They get the sleep problems. Not only that, because of this sleep problem, they are depressive in nature during winter in most of the so melatonin, our internal circadian, in the one of the previous slides, in the initial slides, I have shown about this melatonin internal circadian, internal time giving signal, which is regulating our sleep. When melatonin is having its peak, we are going to sleep. The person is under sleep. So this rhythmic melatonin secretion is affected because of the very low sunlight during winter season. So that melatonin administration should be done at a proper time point. Not only that, the phototherapy, artificial light, because sunlight is very less, the patients have to be given artificial bright light, that is called phototherapy. At that time, the seasonal affective disorder is minimized, and there is improvement in their sleep. So timed bright light therapy, that bright light therapy, if you give in the evening, there is no point. That bright light therapy, the exposure to the bright light during winter season in those sad patients, seasonal affective disorder patients, the light therapy must be done in the morning 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. If he receives light, what happens is there is a perfect rhythmic oscillation that can be regenerated in the subject, because of the bright light, it suppresses the melatonin level to a large extent. So it is completely minimized during daytime. The nighttime, the synthesis is somewhat elevated because of the feedback neuronal inputs that is happening. Feedback regulation is happening via the synthesis of the serotonin and also the neuronal inputs to the pineal gland. So this is this light therapy particularly being done during winter. This is the bright light around 10,000 lux. This there must be a time dependent. Morning phototherapy is very good, rather than having this phototherapy during afternoon or during in the evening, then the subject cannot be relieved from the symptoms of the SAD. In the morning, since it suppresses the melatonin level to a larger extent, there is a feedback input that is happening via these neuronal mechanisms, and so that the melatonin can be synthesized properly during night time, the subject is having a proper sleep and the depressive symptoms are relieved. Because of the lack of sunlight, the people have to depend upon the bright sunlight. People living in India are fortunate as far as this light exposure is considered. Otherwise, your sleep is perfectly damaged. So that is the problem. This kind of chronobiology and this kind of biological clock function is important for the people who are living in the satellites, which are circling around the Earth. They are not exposed to the 24-hour light or cycle. So among them, the clock function has to be considered. Its rhythmic functions are to be monitored. And why not? Nowadays, people are there. You are not having the perfect light or cycle as we are having Earth. So there, the main consideration must be to align, to synchronize, to entrain our body clock, our biological clock, to match this 24-hour periodicity. First, that research must be there. Otherwise, your clock functions, all the biological functions are affected because of the lack of sleep problems. The depressive symptoms will be more. And why not? We have seen lots of examples. All these endocrine functions are affected. The person is now not going to lead a healthy life in Mars because of this variation in the 24-hour LIDAR cycle. So, hello participants, please be ready to synchronize your body clock to the perfect 24-hour periodicity when you are going to go to Mars. So, there is sometimes our body clock must be enhanced. The body clock amplitude of the rhythms must be elevated. Sometimes the body clock function must be suppressed. We need to alter the periodicity. The melatonin rhythm, if it is not a 24-hour period, and on the other hand, if it is 20-hour period, regularly that a person is having in synchronizing his body clock to the external environment, and a lot of problems will be there. Not only that, the phase of a particular rhythm to the phase of the another rhythm must be perfectly coordinated and aligned. As I told, the peripheral clocks, which are located in peripheral organs, must be perfectly aligned with the master clock. So all these problems have been detected, and these are these drugs that have been used to enhance the function of the central suprachiasmatic nuclei, or to suppress, to alter the period, to align the phase of the clock, and for the perfect alignment of the peripheral clocks to the central clock. So you might be knowing about this jet lag. That is a transmeridian dystronism. People traveling, crossing the time zones rapidly, or having this temporary problem in getting a proper sleep, and all other digestive problems are there. Blood pressure rhythm is affected. All those problems is there temporarily, about 3 days to 1 week. This jet lag problem is there, and after that, that person is synchronized to the new light or cycle environment. After that, he will be having this rhythmic sleep wake cycle. But these 3 to 7 days, the subject is affected by this jet lag, and there is physical discomfort, there is poor sleep, even your performance is getting affected because of this jet lag. Only if you give having proper sleep, then all other rhythmic functions will be somehow associated with this perfect sleep wake cycle. So even from San Francisco to London, 8 time zones must be crossed. So at the time, the melatonin is synchronizing our body clock most efficiently. 5 mg of melatonin, 18 hours local time must be taken, and 3 days prior to start of the journey. 3 days prior to start of the journey, this dose of melatonin is recommended. And after reaching London, without to get relieved of these jet lag symptoms, 4 days of melatonin administration, 5 mg is recommended to alleviate these symptoms. Even otherwise, we can go to the normal synchrony. But there is a temporary 1 week problem in getting proper sleep and digestion and all those things. So there are molecular mechanisms that have been worked out. Melatonin is a lipophilic molecule. It can cross the cell membrane without any receptor, or melatonin receptors are there. Through that, it is having adenylate cyclase or phospholipase C, and it is acting at the gene level, regulating not only the sleep but all other mechanisms, including the antioxidant function, cellular proliferation function, and so on. I told about these clock genes. If there is a problem, in the clock gene, for example, period, HPER2 and HPER3 are clock genes, human period 3 and human period 2 clock genes. If there is a mutation in these genes, that lead to familial forms of sleep disorders called sleep phase delay syndrome and sleep phase advanced syndrome. How to rectify that? Here I am giving an example. The subject is suffering from advanced sleep phase syndrome. You see the subject, he cannot be awake after 19:20. After 7:30, he is not able to awake. He is advanced sleep. He is getting advanced sleep recurrently, and this problem is chronic in nature, affecting his health and other routine schedule of the body. How to rectify that? Because this is genetic disorder. One way is to get this phototherapy in the morning. It is synchronizing his body clock to the external 24-hour cycle. Another treatment is melatonin administration at a particular time point. So these are the clock genes. It is not a single gene, but around 10 genes are there. Cryptochrome 1, Cry1, Cry2, cryptochrome 1 and 2, period 1 and 2 are important clock genes, controlled by other two clock genes, proteins of the other two clock genes, namely CLOCK and BMAL. There are also other genes, RevERB and ROR. They are doing dual role. They are acting as clock genes, and are also they are involved in lipid metabolism. You know that RevERB alpha, it is a main lipid metabolism controlling gene. This is not only acting as a clock gene, but also in the metabolism process in general. So they positively regulate CLOCK and BMAL. They positively regulate the expression of these four genes. On the other hand, these two, period 1 and period 2, they suppress the expression of this BMAL1 temporarily. So temporarily there is an oscillation of these genes because of the feedback mechanism. The ROR positively regulated the expression of BMAL1 and also this CRY1. So it is a little bit complex kind of regulatory mechanism that have been discovered. And for that, they have received a Nobel Prize in 2017. So this kind of expression, you can see that oscillation. So there is a variation. This time, this represents the peak time, and this represents the low level. based on the 24 hour periodicity. And Rev-ERB and ROR are also controlled by the clock BMAL one. There is a complex network of regulatory mechanism. So if any one of these clock gene is affected, the whole cascade is getting affected. So because of the regulation of these genes, they control other clock controlled genes. As we have seen, they control numerous clock controlled genes, leading to the overall temporal control of the physiology and other bodily functions. So in this slide, I have represented during daytime. During daytime, all these genes are high, or the proteins are expressed, the gene is transcribed, and ultimately they are translated. The BMAL gene, clock gene, this is not expressed during daytime because of that feedback mechanism I have told. During nighttime, you see BMAL1 is high, and all these gene expression is low. And they in turn regulate the numerous clock controlled genes involved in numerous cellular processes. So if there is a problem, if there is a mutation in the clock gene, first that lead to sleep disorders. Not only that, what about other rhythmic functions, including cell division and hormonal production, including BP and numerous cellular processes, so on. That leads to cancer. You see, problem period is a period per two clock gene. If there is a mutation, it leads to lymphoma, rib cancer, colorectal cancer. Hello? Including neurodegenerative disorder and so on and so forth. Mutation or polymorphisms, that leads to several problems, not only in sleep, but other health problems are also there. As I have represented in this slide. Hello, can I take 5 more minutes? Madam?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue. Yes, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Hello, can you hear, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Yeah. So there is a molecular level at gene level, you can see these variations in the genes and all problems, and including tumor are arising. You see, this is shown in MPER2 mouse period 2 clock gene mutant. If it is mutated, you see the occurrence of tumor is very high. Tumor in the salivary gland, tumor in the kidney is happening to a larger extent because of the lack of the perfect coordinated, lack of the coordination in the hormonal rhythm leads to lack of control in the cell division, and leading to aberrant cell growth, uncontrolled cell growth. There are various mechanisms that have been worked out. We know that molecular mechanisms to a larger extent, but I am not having enough time. So I will just see only important points. So you see, we have seen these four clock genes. We remember BMAL1 clock, period 1, 2, 3, and the cryptogram 1, 2 we have seen. So both these positive and negative regulators are regulating each other temporarily in a 24-hour period manner. So what are these cytochrome P450, sulfur transferases? All these are drug metabolizing enzymes. So the enzyme levels, the receptor levels, the expression of all these genes are controlled genetically, are controlled by these important clock genes. You see, why the variation of the drug is showing rhythmic variation, because of the variation in the drug metabolizing enzymes, the receptors for the drug, they show temporal variation based on the output, based on the output of these clock proteins. These are controlled, these processes are controlled, and as a result, you get the 24-hour variation in the efficacy of the drug, in the pharmacokinetics of the drug, the toxicity varies. A drug which is normally, which should have a good effect, is showing a toxic effect because of the variation, temporal variation, and that is how the time of day dependence of the drug is resulted. So there is a perfect coordination in the variation of the all these drug metabolizing proteins and the drug receptors. So according to this variation, the chronotherapy must be scheduled to have a very good, healthier living. So here you say reverb. We have seen in one of the previous slides I have shown. We know BMAL clock period 1, 2, 3, cry 1 and cry 2. So these are the clock genes. There you see how they control these numerous cellular process, cellular redox, including cellular metabolism, all the three metabolism, carbohydrate, lipid, protein metabolism, the cellular energy levels. They control the translation of so many other genes. They are involved in the circadian rhythm of cholesterol synthesis, fatty acid synthesis. The HMG-CoA reductase level is high. Why? Because of this rhythmic regulation of by these clock genes, genobiotic metabolism, cell cycle in the relief of the stress. You see, all these are important cellular processes which are rhythmic, and the molecular mechanism have been worked out to a larger extent. And these are called chronobiotics. These drugs, we have seen if the clock is suppressed, if the clock is not having perfect alignment with the peripheral clocks, these chronobiotics can be administered, which can align the peripheral clocks, or it will enhance the clock function. Based on the defect, we can administer these drugs, and they are very, it goes on. More and more information now we are getting. These are the metabolic defects, not only the tumor. If all these clock genes are defective in nature, how it leads to various diseases, you see, like hyperglycemia, hypertension, increase the serum triglycerides. The culprit is the mutation of the clock gene, ultimately leading to all these of health problems. I think I can stop here. Thank you very much. And here I am showing once again the presentation sources from all these, taken the pictures and information from these references. Thank you. I will be happy to answer.
Dear participants, anybody having doubts can write down your doubts in the chat box. We will read it out for sir. Any questions can be typed down in the chat box. Sir, there is a question from Salia SB. How can this chronotherapy be useful for neurodegenerative diseases?
Yes, it is of course useful, but it is at the experimental stage or in the clinical trial stage. We need to do a lot of research, but we know that in one of the slides I have told, the sleep function, the rest activity cycle, and the sleep function, it is not happening rhythmically. It is throughout the day and night, the subject is having sleep, the subject is having activity, it is not perfectly coordinated. First, if we coordinate that clock function, somehow we could stop that neurodegenerative problems. And nowadays there are several phytochemicals that have been used. What they are doing, these phytochemicals, they somehow stop this neurodegeneration, but his clock function is still problematic. If the clock function is problematic, then you are not looking at the core problem. So we need to choose a drug which is having both the property to make the alignment of the clock, to make the synchrony of the clock to the external environment, as well as the drug must have the must suppress the neurodegenerative effect. If in this if the drug is having both the effects, then it is having a very good effect. Of course, the chronotherapy is very, very useful. There is no exception. Without chronotherapy, you cannot have your most efficient drug. But you see, this is even for the treatment for neurodegeneration is at experimental stage. Okay, so if you want to increase the efficacy of the drug, we need research. We need further research at the experimental model level and also the clinical level to have a very good effect. But we can hypothesize definitely chronotherapy will be useful to increase the efficacy of your particular drug. Or if you fight, for example, even naringenin and so many phytochemicals are having very good effect, we should also administer the good chronobiotic, which should align, which should synchronize that the clock of the neurodegenerative patient, so that the efficacy will be elevated.
Sir, one more doubt, sir, from Mr. Krishna Kishore. How alcohol is effective in biological clocks, since it's used in some medicines?
It is used in medicine in a jovial way. I can tell that when most people, the drinkers, I think they choose what time. Mid-time, early morning time, I don't think so. Evening time. Because you see that enzymes metabolizing your alcohol is showing rhythmicity. It is not uniform. You have effect, but that variation. What I am saying is variation. Variation evening time is the effect of alcohol is more. But along we are not taking alcohol not as a drug. It is mixed with other drugs, you know. It is present only in the low quantity. In many drugs, in cough syrups, alcohol is there. But it is since it is alcohol itself is minimum quantity, it may have a negligible effect.
Okay, next one more doubt, sir, from Dr. S. Sundaresan Sivapadam. How about neonatal jaundice and light therapy?
Yes, light therapy.
How about neonatal jaundice?
Yes. Neonatal jaundice, for neonatal jaundice, that light therapy is recommended. Light therapy not only for this sleep problems, but there, depending upon, we have to do the personalized medicine. The rhythmicity of that symptoms must be monitored, and we need to not during afternoon or in the evening. For the jaundice, we should not do the light therapy in the night. The perfect time is morning 4 to 6. At that time point, the phototherapy is done. Then you are relieving the problem. I have shown the slide. It is having its effect on the raphe nuclei and the ventromedial hypothalamus, in the pineal gland. The neuronal projections and the feedback inhibition must be reached properly so that they can be stimulated and the symptoms are relieved.
Okay, sir. The next doubt from Soumya Ranjan Satrusal. How to change the mindset of youths of today about the usefulness of rhythmic circadian rhythm and persuade them to avoid sleeping late night?
Very good. It is a very good question, which is a need of the hour. Now people, we are living in 24/7. We are active day and night. That means what? Our body clock is completely affected. You see, we need to get sleep. We need, you may call it as a joke. We need 9 hours of sleep. Even the adult person needs 9 hours of sleep. You imagine any country about 100 years back. There is no artificial 100 or 200 years back. They had 9 hours sleep. Even in USA, people lived about a century ago. They have average sleep is 8 hours. Why? That sleep is very, very important to maintain your health. If you are not having enough sleep, psychiatric problems, cancer, even why not diabetes, all neurodegenerative disorders, even that may be caused. the people are forgetting the importance of sleep. We should have a perfect sleep. 7 to 9 hour sleep is recommended. That is the message that I want to give to the younger participants. Don't leave it like that. Don't leave it like a joke. It is very, very important to have a proper 7 to 9 hour sleep. You shouldn't use a mobile phone. They say that I told melatonin. Melatonin, the internal state giver, the melatonin hormone is called sleep hormone. That hormone is elevated during dark time, which is giving sleep to our body. That melatonin hormone peak, that rhythm is affected whenever you get light after 10 o'clock. After 10 p.m., please switch off your lights. After 10 p.m., if you have the light, that suppresses your melatonin level. You will not have a sound sleep. You will not have a very good REM sleep. Rapid eye movement sleep is the deep sleep that you should have. Even 2 to 2.5 hour of REM sleep is must. Within a sleep, we have several stages. Slow REM sleep, which is the deep sleep, you require 2 to 2.5 hour of REM sleep. For that, melatonin must reach a peak. The problem is, after 10 p.m., if you have light, that affects our REM sleep, that affects all our bodily functions. You may not know, there is scientific literature between association of biological clock and diabetes. The diabetes insulin sensitivity and insulin less amount of insulin secretion. And we have seen insulin itself is rhythmic in nature. If we are not getting sleepy, we are more prone to be diabetic. That is happening in the shift workers. Shift workers, which they normally work during night hours also, they are more to be more diabetic because of the misalignment of our body clock. This problem is happening. So don't treat it as light. Getting 7 hours of sleep, getting minimum 7 hours of sleep per day is very, very important to maintain a good health.
Sir, Dr. Adiseshu Gidugu is asking, will the coffee, tea, etc. also will affect certainly, the biological clock?
Certainly, because caffeine is a stimulant. It is a stimulant. Actually, it is making you active and it is suppressing your sleep. The coffee taken in the evening after 4 p.m. you will definitely affects your sleep because it is a stimulant. It suppresses the melatonin secretion. It always keeps you active. So, taking a coffee, taking caffeine, even chocolate consumption in the evening hours will suppress your sleep. Caffeine definitely causes the rhythmicity problems in the rhythmicity of melatonin. It prevents the peak level of melatonin, and your sleep is getting affected. So, doctors are nowadays advising not to take coffee after 4 p.m.
Next, Mr. Rajaram asks, how do chronotherapy help in having good sleep in case of insomnia individual? Yes.
That is a very good question. You say that the clock genes are there. If there is a polymorphism there is a severe mutation, if there is a deletion of a particular nucleotide sequence in the clock gene, makes the genetic familial sleep problem, familial advanced sleep wake syndrome and the familial delayed sleep wake syndrome are there. Even those patients are treated effectively by melatonin. Melatonin, if it is administered, it makes the subject to go to sleep. Or melatonin is a chemical. It is the hormone that is to be administered exogenously. So it is somewhat harmful because chemically we are taking. The natural remedy is going for phototherapy. Phototherapy in the morning. The person can go for a walk. 1 hour light exposure, bright sunlight exposure, more than 10,000 lux. The luminosity must be more than 10,000 lux. The light exposure of 1 to 2 hours in the morning, 5 to 7 a.m., the bright light exposure and, of course, the morning walk, 2 hour walk. It does is, it suppresses your melatonin level via this mechanism. I have told in one of the slides, your melatonin levels are completely suppressed. And in the night time, the enzymes are stimulated, getting a peak in the melatonin, which makes you have a sound sleep. So for those insomnia patients, naturally that can be cured by having a light exposure in the morning hours and also by doing morning exercise, that symptoms, that sleep problems can be avoided. You can yourself try. Just to go for expose yourself to the bright light exposure in the morning for 2 hours, and after 1 week, you can write to me how your sleep is improved. But the light exposure should not be done in the evening, after 6 p.m. or at the 10 p.m. That exposure that will cause the severity of the symptoms more.
Sir, can we minimize the time of sleeping by the light therapy?
Why you want to minimize sleep? Because we should have 7 to 9 hours of sleep. That is the recommended time. If you minimize, you are calling for health problems. Maybe temporarily. Temporarily by taking coffee and stimulant. Normally, students are studying for exams, no? Temporarily, that can be done. But not regularly, chronically.
Next, Ms. Anuradha David is asking, has the biological clock or circadian rhythms shown any evolutionary trend with environmental factors such as chemical contaminants due to pollution, global warming, climate change, etc.?
Yes, very good question. First, I will come to that evolutionary aspect. You might be knowing, before millions of years ago, our earth rotation, daily rotation is not 24 hours. It is 20 hour, starting from 20 hour. Now the earth rotation is slowing down. Not that means next year it is not 24.5. It is not like that. It takes millions of years to have this 24 hour period. And you can refer literature that at the time where dinosaurs were living in this globe, the light cycle was 20 hours. Slowly, there is a slowing down of earth rotation because they say the moon is getting closer and closer by few millimeter every year. So that it makes the earth rotation slower. So from 20 years now it is 24 hours. See, so asked the evolutionary aspect. So our body clock is now it is synchronized to the 24 hour light dark schedule. That innate body clock is synchronized. Okay. So after a few thousand years or a few millions of years, if the earth rotation is slowing down and if the earth diurnal cycle is 26 hours, our body clock will be tuned to a 24 hour light hour cycle period. So of course this pollution, all these health hazards, global warming, all these are having in one or other way they are affecting our body clock. Certainly. So that is having important influence on living in Mars and other planets and so on. I told the satellite people are not exposed to 12 hour and 12 hours of darkness. They are not getting a light dark cycle properly. Their sleep function and all other health will be affected. What about in Mars? It is not 12 hour or 24 hour light periodicity. The quantity intensity of the light in Mars is very low. Not only that, we are getting the cosmic ray, gamma rays and other radiation in Mars, but this duration of light is also important. That directly affects your body clock. So evolutionarily, we are evolved to have this body clock of about 24 hour period. Not only that, this global warming, all this pollution, certainly they are affecting our body clock. Yes, one question, when overexpression of melatonin levels, having a very high content of anything is harmful to the body. So one important function, you increase the melatonin level, take melatonin injection during daytime, what happens is it immediately makes you drowsy and you immediately go to sleep. So that problem is happening. The melatonin levels are high. The subject goes to sleep. Melatonin and sleep, they cannot be separated from each other.
Sir, here one more doubt, sir. Sir, some infertility problems in the women also affect this biological clock, as I have studied. Can you please explain this? What is a woman's biological clock, and how will it affect them during menopause?
Yes, madam. In this lecture, I have talked only about the circadian rhythm, about 24-hour rhythm only I have talked, but there are other kinds of rhythms, infradian rhythm, ultradian rhythm, seasonal rhythm and annual rhythm. So the menstrual cycle is an example of infradian rhythm. So you see that hormone level is not only having a peak and trough, maximum and minimum level over the 24-hour period, but it is having a infradian rhythm also in the over a month, around a month period, the hormonal rhythms are there. So depending upon every day light or secure, every day circadian rhythm of this female hormone have the influence on the ultradian rhythm or the menstrual cycle of the rhythm. So that means if the menstrual cyclicity is not happening properly, it definitely affects the fertility. It has to be important, and the studies have been conducted on that. The hormonal rhythm and the menstrual cycle periodicity is of course having in the fertility problem.
I have explained
that question only. If there is more melatonin is not produced by a single gene. There are five different genes, and the serotonin is the precursor. All the five enzymes are involved in the production of melatonin. If all those five enzymes are overexpressed, that leads to always under sleep. Maybe Kumbharna must have a very good, very very high level of melatonin for a longer period. That's how he is getting 6 months of sleep. Having high amount of melatonin during daytime is also harmful. It not only makes you sleep during daytime, but your nighttime sleep is also affected. So having a perfect rhythm of melatonin at proper level is important.
Sir, is it possible to lower or cure Alzheimer's using marijuana?
Marijuana, I am not well aware of that, madam. I am not well aware. But I think it is on the trial. There is no perfect treatment that can be applied to that Alzheimer patient. It is under trial only. The treatment is not successful in each and every case, like other diseases. For example, diabetes, we are able to control to a larger extent. Even diabetic patients can live up to 90 to 95 years. But this treatment, I think that the treatment has to be improved properly.
Any other doubts, participants? It was a nice interactive session. Now I request my colleague, Ms. Velagapudi Kavita, to read out the vote of thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. On behalf of Department of Biotechnology, I would like to take the opportunity to propose the formal vote of thanks. Firstly, we thank the management of Umbrella College for giving us this opportunity to conduct the webinar. We thank Dr. P. Subramanian Garu, Professor at Annamalai University, for accepting our request and invitation to be today's speaker for the webinar. We extend our thanks to all the participants in showing interest for registering to this webinar event. Thank you. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you, madam. I am happy to deliver this lecture. I am thankful for this opportunity to talk on this topic. I am thankful to our respected principal, Dr. Victor Emmanuel sir, and Madam Sri Lakshmi Samanchi, which showed a tremendous interest in organizing this talk. I am thankful to the organizing secretary, Kavita Madam, also. Thank you for the wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Now I request participants to submit the feedback form. Those who have submitted can leave the meeting. This link will be open till 12 p.m. now. So anybody who has to still submit the feedback form, please do that. We'll not be posting it in WhatsApp again, since the number of participants is limited to this Google Meet only. Form. I think I have posted it. Just a minute.
One, two, three, four. 4 inches above.